I entered the profession against my will, and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death. And given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed would restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. B. Nalin Kumar has practiced in Andhra Pradesh since 1981. Starting his career in law in the office of Advocate Lalit Chari in Mumbai in 1980, he moved to Hyderabad and joined the office of K.G. Kannabiran in 1981. A lawyer with a versatile practice, he set up an independent office in 1991, but continued to work closely with K.G. Kannabiran on a daily basis till his death in 2010. Assisting senior, as he calls him, in cases ranging from company law to encounters, Nalin Kumar was K.G. Kannabiran's go-to person for 30 years, holding fort on an everyday level, anchoring the kaleidoscopic range of cases that came to Kannabiran, and providing support with rare commitment, professional diligence and deep affection. Self-effacing to a fault, Nalin Kumar's role in ensuring enabling conditions for K.G. Kannabiran's human rights practice was vital.
I am happy to give this talk in remembrance of my beloved senior, Mr. K.G. Kannabiran. In this talk, I will refer to him only as senior. Senior, popularly known as KGK, to his friends and legal fraternity, was a multifaceted personality. I wish to give an insight into his attributes as a lawyer, focusing on the enormous work done by him in defending civil rights, as well as the versatile cases he conducted in branches other than civil rights. Senior was a person of great intellect and integrity. This intellect and integrity was coupled with high principles. Because of his affable nature, high professional caliber, and helping nature, he was very popular among the members of the bar. He was widely known in the then combined state of Andhra Pradesh and outside the state. Whenever he visited a district court, young lawyers used to gather around him just to see him and to listen to him. It was the principle of senior not to campaign for any position in life. True to his principle, without any campaign, he was elected president of the then AP High Court Advocates Association and a member of the then AP Bar Council for 2 terms of 5 years each. This bears testimony not only to his popularity, but also to the good professional work he did in various fields. For senior, cause came first, and reward for his professional services last. He was in the forefront in fighting state repression. In his professional career, he had filed a number of writ petitions to vindicate fundamental freedoms of the activists who were subjected to state repression for their anti-governmental work. The relevance of this work today is very evident to us all. Senior defended the accused in Secunderabad conspiracy case. The accused included revolutionary writer Varvara Rao and poet Bhaskar Reddy, popularly known as Charabanda Raju. The charge against the accused was that they entered into a conspiracy to commit gruesome offenses like murder and arson, to create terror and to bring about an armed revolution to overthrow the popularly elected government. The case was registered in 1975 and the trial went on for 15 long years. I joined his office while this case was in progress and had the opportunity to observe his approach to law of conspiracy and his legal strategies from close quarters. Senior was the only advocate who defended the accused from day one till they were acquitted in 1989. He cross-examined about 200 witnesses and advanced arguments in defense for over 3 months. Senior did not charge any professional fee for the stupendous work. He used to say he spent one third of his professional life in defending the accused in Ramnagar conspiracy, in Secunderabad conspiracy case. Similarly, he defended the accused in Ramnagar conspiracy case and the old Bangalore conspiracy case, which also lasted for long durations. These were the cases that were conducted in sessions courts in Hyderabad. In this case, as well as in securing acquittals of all the accused and in conducting criminal trials, Senior demonstrated concrete methods in challenging state impunity. This was educative for judges and lawyers. Designated senior advocate of the combined High Court of Andhra Pradesh, Senior was popularly known as a lawyer who specialized in civil rights and criminal law. But the truth is, he was a versatile lawyer who practiced with ease in all jurisdictions, from the Court of Munsi Magistrate to Supreme Court and in all branches of law. He practiced actively in constitutional law, human rights, labor laws, criminal and civil laws, property laws, company law, admiralty law, rent control law, etc. Senior in a single day could defend an accused in a criminal case before the Munsif Magistrate and prosecute a civil suit in the district court in the forenoon and reach High Court by post-lunch session to argue a big case involving interpretation of complex questions of constitutional law. Senior never showed any tension or felt any pressure when he had to argue different cases in a single day. In between cases, he had time to travel on fact-finding missions wherever there were human rights violations, participate in police processes, and engaged in many other public activities. Looking at law as an instrument to serve public good, he always attempted to interpret law in a way that would serve the public interest, but not individuals, including his clients. To illustrate versatile practice of the senior, I will deal with a few cases conducted by him in different fields of law. As a civil rights lawyer, he opposed police encounters of political activists right from the early 1970s, but especially during and after emergency. After killing political activists in alleged encounters, the police claimed it as a measure of self-defense and closed the cases without even registering a first information report. Senior used to say that local police lacked skills to shoot a running target. Therefore, he said, the police first capture the target and then shoot. Hence, all encounter deaths were culpable homicides amounting to murder. One Mr. Madhusudan Raj was killed at Hyderabad in the intervening night of 26th, 27th July 1997. But the police proclaimed that an unidentified member of the People's War Group, PWG, was shot dead. This was reported in Indian Express dated 27-7-1997. In a first of its kind, Senior, on the basis of the news report, made an oral application to the Bench of Chief Justice, who treated it as a writ petition, showing Senior as the petitioner, and passed a series of interim orders, among others, to preserve evidence. The principal contention at the hearing was that the defense of the police, that they had justification to fire at Madhusudan Raj, which resulted in his killing, is a matter to be tested at the trial by the criminal court. The Bench of Chief Justice, accepting that contention, entrusted the investigation to Central Bureau of Investigation. This case was reported in 1997, Volume 4, Andhra Law Times, page number 591, under the title K.G. Kannabiran versus the Chief Secretary. This issue again came up in a group of cases under the title of AP Civil Liberties Committee versus Government of AP, reported in 2009, Volume 2, Andhra Legal Decisions, page number 1. This case was decided by a larger bench of 5 judges. The issue was referred to a larger bench for reconsideration of law laid down by an earlier full bench. The full bench held that an independent FIR shall be registered only on a specific complaint made alleging that any identified individual had caused the death on account of bullet injuries in an encounter with the police, and in the absence of such a specific complaint, the police had to follow the procedure under 176 of the Code of Criminal Procedure without prejudice to investigation. Senior explained the legal provisions and contended that registration of first information report was mandatory whether offender was identified or not, as otherwise it would violate fundamental rights and give a free hand to the police. He argued for a reconsideration of the full bench decision. The larger bench, inter alia, on a critical analysis of provisions of criminal procedure code, held that where a police officer causes death of a person acting or purporting to act in discharge of his official duties or in self-defense, as the case may be, first information report shall be recorded and investigated, and the defense of the accused police officer had to be decided only during trial before a criminal court, but not during investigation. Significantly, the court held that first information report had to be recorded whether an alleged perpetrator is named or not. Thus, the larger bench overruled earlier law laid down by the full bench. To make the narration complete, I may also mention that AP Police Officers Association filed SLP against the judgment of the larger bench, which was disposed of in terms of an earlier judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of PUCL versus State of Maharashtra, reported in 2014, Volume 10, Supreme Court Cases, page 635, where it was, among others, held that when an encounter takes place by use of firearm by a police party resulting in death, a first information report had to be registered. The arguments he set out in the cases he fought on challenging state impunity in criminal courts and constitutional courts have very far-reaching impact on jurisprudence till present time. He used to spend a great deal of time and effort to educate judges and sensitize the courts on issues of constitutional rights, especially pertaining to right to life and personal liberty. Second case I was of a very different case that I will narrate briefly involves the loss of livelihood faced by small traders, mostly belonging to minority community, on account of road widening near Charminar. Senior adopted a novel method to secure livelihood while accepting that road widening was necessary and acceptable. In this matter, small traders who were mostly tenants were sought to be displaced from their shops for road widening by the local urban development authority. Senior filed a writ petition challenging the displacement of traders for road widening. At the hearing, Senior made elaborate submissions that the state cannot deprive livelihood of small traders for road widening without providing alternative place for eking out livelihood. He contended that such a deprivation would infringe the fundamental right guaranteed under Article 21 of the Constitution of India. After sufficiently persuading the bench and after ensuring that the court was with him, he proposed that the local urban development authority provide shops to such traders at alternative locations subject to conditions. The local urban development authority was persuaded to accept that proposal. Finally, under the supervision of the High Court, alternative shops were provided to the traders. This was the real succor to the traders instead of paltry compensation that would have been paid in case of acquisition of land for a public purpose. On conclusion of the matter, traders came in large numbers in a large bus to our office to express their gratitude. This way, Senior solved one human problem. This also gave us immense professional satisfaction. More importantly, through this small case, he set out a different parameter for understanding eminent domain and land acquisition for public purpose, where inevitably it is poor and marginalized communities that are at the receiving end. The third case concerns property matters, which he would conduct with ease. One such case was that of Rich Hotel of Hyderabad. Kapoors of Bombay were running this hotel under a lease with the state government for several decades. The lease deed provided for a renewal of lease, but the clause was not clear. Nonetheless, Senior filed a suit for special performance of renewal clause in the lease deed. At the hearing, which lasted several weeks, Senior cited a number of authorities in support of his contention that the court has to interpret the renewal clause keeping in mind the intention of the parties, which was to renew the lease. The civil court, accepting Senior's contention, directed renewal of lease against which the government filed an appeal before the High Court but was unsuccessful. At this stage, government terminated lease by exercising the power under AP Government Lands and Buildings, Termination of Leases Act 1986, to set at naught judgment of the High Court affirming the renewal of lease. The government proposed to develop Rich Hotel site as a heritage hotel, but presently the property is under lock and key. The government neither allowed Kapoor's to run the hotel nor put it to any use for over 25 years. However, his innovative approach to cases, big and small, focused on justice and equity. This was the most important learning for us on an everyday basis. The fourth case was that of Andhra Bank Limited, a premier private bank that was nationalized by an Act of Parliament passed in 1980. Under the Act, the shareholders were to be paid compensation in lieu of nationalization of the bank towards the value of the shares. However, Board of Directors of Andhra Bank Limited, like KLN Prasad and others who had controlling interest, wanted to start another company by investing the compensation amount. The shareholders represented by Senior filed company petitions before the then Combined High Court of Andhra Pradesh for winding up of Andhra Bank Limited and distribution of compensation among shareholders. At the trial, Senior cross-examined KLN Prasad elaborately, during which he extracted valuable admissions. However, a single judge of the High Court dismissed the company petitions. Senior preferred company appeals before a division bench of Chief Justice Alladi Krupaswamy Iyer and another. Incidentally, the father of the Chief Justice, Sri Alladi Krishnaswamy Iyer, settled the memorandum and articles of association of Andhra Bank Limited. At the hearing, Senior made elaborate submissions on innumerable facts and many principles of law, very rarely referring to law books. He contended that only banking business was being conducted by Andhra Bank Limited. Hence, by virtue of nationalization, the banking business could not be carried on, and hence the substratum of the company was lost. He requested the court to pass an order of winding up of Andhra Bank Limited on just and equitable grounds. The bench of Chief Justice, taking note of the fact that the name of the bank itself, the name itself was Andhra Bank, which could no longer carry on the business of banking by virtue of nationalization, and it did not carry on any other business other than banking, and Board of Directors could not disclose the exact business which they intended to carry on with compensation, ordered winding up on just and equitable ground. This case was reported in 1983, volume 53, company cases, page number 73, under the title Nagavarpu Krishnaprasad versus Andhra Bank Limited. It's a different point that the matter was taken up in appeal to the Supreme Court, where shareholders who filed company petitions for winding up of Andhra Bank Limited compromised with the Board of Directors. To speak briefly about the way Senior trained his juniors to stand in court and argue cases. In his chamber, if any junior was ready with any case, he would give him an opportunity to argue before the court. He was truly benevolent. I started working in the chambers of Senior since 1981. It was a real pleasure working with him because he gave full freedom to the juniors to prepare cases in their own way, but he was ready to step in to correct and guide them when required. Senior was a voracious reader of not only law books, but general books on different subjects. On a given court working day, he used to be in his chambers by 7:30 a.m. doing research for the cases of the day. Very often, he used to stand before the bookshelves in the chambers and do the research himself instead of calling for the books. He had phenomenal memory and could recall authorities which were decided decades ago. He used to read a brief, however voluminous it was, only once, and remember the facts for years together before it came up for final hearing. Senior used to inspire his juniors by his in-depth preparation, lucid and authoritative presentation of facts and law before courts, and espousal of public causes. He advised his juniors to remember that behind every brief, there was a human suffering, and as a lawyer, the very best in the case should be brought out. His advice to juniors was to close the brief once it was completely read and think about it continuously to formulate what questions of fact and law would arise, how to present them, how to meet the possible contentions on the other side. If it was a trial matter at the stage of evidence, to think about the questions to be put in the cross-examination, possible answers, and further questions to be put. He used to say that the legal profession is the only profession where one could get a chance to deal with different subjects and provide an opportunity to fight for human rights and various freedoms given under the Constitution. To illustrate his encouragement of his juniors, I refer to an incident of 1985. When Senior was arguing a matter before a division bench, a civil appeal of Kerala Transport Company reached for hearing before another division bench. When I asked him for instructions as to what I should do, he asked me whether I was ready. I told him I was ready, thinking that he would take over the case that he was, after the case that he was arguing concluded. He instructed me to start the case. The matter was part heard and it got adjourned to next day for continuation. That evening, after the routine work was over, about 9 p.m., I went to Senior to brief him about Kerala Transport case and that he should appear in the case next day. Even before I had said anything further, he simply said he will not take over a case which his junior started. He instructed me to go ahead with the case without worrying about the result. This case was of importance because principal decided in this case would have a bearing on the thousands of tenants in the state. The civil appeal was filed against an eviction decree passed by the civil court against Kerala Transport Company from a tenanted building. During the pendency of civil appeal, the Supreme Court struck down a provision in the AP Rent Control Act which exempted buildings fetching a rent of more than ₹1,000 per month from the purview of rent control law. It was our contention that because of striking down of exemption provision, the civil court decree was a nullity and a fresh decree of eviction had to be sought under the AP Rent Control Act. I was worried for two reasons. Firstly, if I made a mistake, it would affect thousands of tenants in the state. Second, Senior would be blamed. So I went to Madam Vasanta Kanaguran about 10 p.m. when Madam was at the dining table. I wanted to appeal to her to prevail upon Senior to take over the case next day. Even before I formulated my appeal, Madam shot down my incomplete appeal in 10 seconds and said, go and do the case as desired by Senior. Left with no option, I reluctantly continued. It was heard over 7 afternoons and finally we succeeded. This is not all. After the verdict came in our favor, Senior instructed Kerala Transport Company to pay me ₹2,000 towards professional fee. I was paid the fee, which was a big amount those days for a raw junior like me. This is the encouragement Senior gave to his juniors at his risk. However, I must confess that the judgment was overruled subsequently on the principle that a cause has to be decided on the basis of law and prevail on the date of institution of the proceeding, and any subsequent change of law would have no bearing. Senior was very serious when in action in court, but not without wit and humor. I end with two incidents in court which I was witness to. A public interest litigation was filed by a third party to declare the strike by junior doctors in Hyderabad as illegal. In that case, Senior represented junior doctors who opposed the writ petition. At the hearing, advocate for petitioner contended the strike was illegal and junior doctors be directed to resume work. After the advocate for the petitioner completed his arguments, the government leader was called upon to argue. The government leader was struggling to find words as everything that the advocate for petitioner said suited the government. At this stage, Senior got up and quipped, what will the government leader say, my lords? The petitioner is none other than the ventriloquist of the government. The whole court, including judges, burst into laughter. In another case, Senior filed a habeas corpus writ petition challenging the preventive detention of one Kottadas, who was reputed to be a notorious criminal. At the hearing, Chief Justice queried, "What, Mr. Kanaviran? You are appearing for Kottadas?" Senior retorted, "I do not know, my lords, whether I am appearing for Kottadas or future Chief Minister. I thank Kalpana Kanaviran for giving me this opportunity."